There are literally thousands of satellites floating around Earth as we speak. Many of them help us with our daily activities, from simple ones like watching TV, surfing the net, and navigating through traffic, to more important stuff like monitoring weather patterns and studying our planet. In other words, were it not for these satellites orbiting Earth, we'd be living completely differently. And that leads us to the question, how exactly did those things get up there? In this video, let's explore how satellites are launched into orbit and how they stay up in the skies for such a long time without crashing. The fact that you're watching this video right now means that somewhere out there, there's a satellite orbiting around the planet, allowing you to do so. You see, satellites are responsible for a lot of the technology and interconnectedness that are considered normal in our modern life. They're the reason why you can instantly connect with friends wherever you are in the world, why you can watch TV shows, why your GPS can point you in the right direction, why weather can easily be predicted, why other stars can be seen light years away, and why military forces can perform operations much easier. The latest data from the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs, or UNOOSA, reveals that there are 8,261 satellites orbiting Earth as of January 2022. 4,852 are active, just barely half of the total number of satellites. The very first satellite was launched into orbit by the Soviet Union, USSR, in October 1957, when they launched Sputnik 1. This effectively triggered the start of the space race between the Soviets and the United States. Since then, other nations have followed suit and launched their own satellites into space. Some of them are huge, like the International Space Station, which is about the size of an American football field. Others are so small they'd easily fit in your backpack. Before we get to know how satellites are launched into orbit, we need to understand the physics that allows them to go up and stay up in the first place. Picture a cannon on a mountain that's positioned horizontally. When it fires, the cannonball will travel parallel to Earth's surface for some time and distance. Eventually, the Earth's gravity would pull it back down to the planet's surface. But if you want the cannonball to travel further before it hits the ground, the cannon needs more gunpowder. The more you add, the more firepower you can give the cannon, and the faster and further the cannonball can travel before gravity catches up to it. Now, under this logic, with a ridiculously high amount of gunpowder, the cannonball can go around the world before falling. Sounds insane? What if I told you that the person that came up with that theory was Isaac Newton? Yep, the guy who, supposedly, got hit by a falling apple and came up with the law of gravity. The thought experiment, now known as Newton's cannonball, was published in 1728, after Newton's death. Nobody put it to the test for the next two centuries, or even knew what to do with it. That was until the Soviets launched Sputnik 1 in 1957. The satellite managed to stay up in space for 3 months before it fell back to Earth. Since then, the satellites that have been launched into orbit followed the same principles behind the Sputnik launch, and obviously improved on them, so they stayed in orbit longer. How much longer? Let's just say a lot longer. So let's get to it. How are satellites launched into orbit? A satellite goes into orbit via a satellite launch vehicle, or SLV. Usually, this is a rocket. Some satellites hitch a ride on a space shuttle before it is released and goes further into orbit. There are two types of SLVs, an expendable launch vehicle, or ELV, and a reusable launch vehicle, or an RLV. As their name suggests, an ELV is destroyed after launching a satellite into orbit, and an RLV returns to Earth and can launch another satellite. A space shuttle is an excellent example of an RLV, as it can be used multiple times to take different satellites into orbit. A satellite's design must be compatible with the launch vehicle that it will use to go into orbit. Regardless of what kind of vehicle launches a satellite, they all start off the same, with the vehicle being positioned at 90 degrees. This isn't just because it's supposed to go up, but it's also the best position for the vehicle to penetrate through the Earth's atmosphere and helps conserve fuel. A satellite's launch into orbit is divided into four stages. The SLV has four components that activate in each stage. Once the launch finishes a stage, the corresponding component of the SLV breaks off from the rest of it. The first stage is the initial launch, carried by the rocket's first stage, which holds the fuel needed to lift it off the ground and high enough to transition to the next stage. Once the rocket takes off, the inertial guidance system of its control mechanism comes into play. The inertial guidance system, or IGS, makes the necessary calculations to adjust the rocket's nozzles and direct the SLV according to the specified flight plan. Usually, the flight plan calls for the SLV to head east. Why? Because the Earth rotates in that direction, thus giving the vehicle a significant boost. This boost also depends on the planet's rotational velocity at the launch location. The Earth rotates fastest at the equator. So the closer an SLV is launched from there, the more of a kick it gets. Once the SLV reaches about 120 miles in height, its first stage breaks off, and the launch transitions to its second phase. The vehicle's second stage, composed of smaller rockets, activates. These rockets have separate fuel tanks and continue to carry the satellite above Earth's atmosphere. Once these smaller rockets have spent their fuel, they break off from the SLV like the first stage. By this time, the SLV should nearly be out of Earth's atmosphere. At this point, the third stage of the launch kicks in. Here, the SLV's upper stage does the lifting and fires its rockets to nudge the satellite into its orbital position. The upper stage is connected to the fairing, a metal shield that holds and protects the satellite from the atmosphere's resistance. Once the SLV exits the Earth's atmosphere, the upper stage disengages and stage 4 of the launch begins. Here, the fairing burns up as it releases the satellite, which moves to a transfer orbit that elevates it higher into space. Once it reaches its intended height in orbit, its solar panels and communication antennas unfurl, and with that, the satellite secures itself in its orbit and becomes operational. Now that we know how satellites are launched into orbit, how do they manage to stay up there? We must go back to Newton's cannonball to understand how satellites do that. The basis of that theory is that gravity always exists between two objects. If not for gravity, a cannonball would continue in a straight direction without ever touching the ground. But because of gravity, the cannonball is pulled down to Earth's surface. The way to prolong the cannonball in the air is to increase its velocity so that gravity takes longer to catch up to it. Now, let's apply that to satellites in orbit. Despite being out of the Earth's atmosphere, satellites are still within the planet's gravitational pull. In other words, gravity constantly pulls the satellite down. Imagine two rubber bands pulling an object from both sides. If one of those rubber bands stops, the object launches in the opposite direction. Now, imagine the snapped rubber band is the velocity of the satellite. If it doesn't achieve the right velocity, gravity will pull that satellite back to Earth and send it crashing. Suppose the snapped rubber is gravity, or the satellite moves beyond Earth's gravitational pull. In that case, it'll continue moving away from the planet until it gets directionless and lost in space. So what does a satellite do? It balances its inertia with Earth's gravity by constantly moving at a certain velocity called orbital velocity. The required velocity of a satellite to balance itself and stay within Earth's orbit is around 17,000 miles per hour at an altitude of 150 miles. But keep in mind that the required orbital velocity depends on how high a satellite is. The closer a satellite is to our planet, the more velocity it needs to stay in orbit. An orbital velocity of 7,000 miles per hour is enough to keep a satellite in orbit if its altitude is 22,223 miles from Earth. But if a satellite moves at that speed while 500 miles away from the Earth, watch out, because that would send it crashing down from the sky. And that's how satellites go up in orbit and stay there for quite some time. So, whenever we use technology to improve our lives, like the internet you're using right now, perhaps we owe our thanks to Sir Isaac Newton. Now, satellites are cool and all, but not as exciting as rockets. The fastest rockets can travel at speeds you can't even imagine, but they can do much more than just fast flying. Check out our video about rockets to learn more, and subscribe to Get Around How so you don't miss our latest updates.